Welcome back. As we promised that we are going to tackle a very important topic in the first segment of this episode of The Breakfast Show, which is the Nile Protection Document, which was signed recently by President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. And also, as I said in the introduction, better late than never. We are going to discuss the details of this document with our dear guest live here in the studio, as we are very much delighted to have him, Dr. Haytham Mamdouh Awad, head of the Irrigation Engineering and Hydraulics in Alexandria University. Thank you very much for being with us, sir, and have a very good morning.
Thank you.
Good morning, Dr. Haytham. Dr. Haytham, how do you see this agreement which was signed to protect the Nile water, which is, of course, a main concern for all Egyptians? And we have to admit that there were many violations taking place on the Nile by the Egyptians themselves. So how do you see this decision and this signing of the agreement? Do you believe that real actions would be actually taken in order to protect the River Nile?
Yes, this was really a very important step. If you imagine that Nile River is our only source of life here in Egypt, all the water passing to Egypt is coming from the south, from Aswan, until reaching the Mediterranean. All our industrial activity are related to Nile River or its main canal coming from the branches, starting from Aswan up to Alexandria in the north. We suffer recently in the past 10 years from a serious environmental problem and pollution of the Nile River. This is due to a lot of industrial and also social activities that a lot of Egyptians are throwing its solid waste and wastewater treatment. The wastewater treatment plants cover only 60% of our Egyptian cities. So in all villages, especially in the lower Egypt, in the Delta, are not treating the wastewater, which are through the two agricultural drain and coming to the north to the Egyptian lagoon. See, so this is very important steps. Just we declare that this important document, which has been signed or inked last Monday or Tuesday, that all of us as Egyptians, we respect Nile River as only or unique source of life for us as Egyptians.
But do we actually respect the River Nile? We know, of course, all Egyptians are aware that it is our only source of water, and we are already suffering from water scarcity. But unfortunately, we are not behaving to protect the water of the Nile. We are misusing our water in a very improper way.
Yes, more than 50,000 recorded slums along the Nile River has been recorded. And until now, the current government just removed from those 50,000 only 3,000 slums. So just imagine that we receive from Nile, River Nile about 55 billion meter cube, and we are reusing all this water again from the drain. We are mixing the water with the fresh water just for agricultural activities. So for sure, we are not respecting that. Not as Egyptians. There is some governmental buildings are built on the River Nile without legal approval. Not only, so this is not for only some governmental buildings, it should be removed. And we have noticed that has been happened in Aswan, for example, and in Minya last 2 weeks, that some governmental bodies, they built some clubs on the Nile without taking the legal steps.
Sir, whenever we are talking about this, what should be our first priority? I mean, is it the industrial issues? I mean, the industrial wastes, or is it the ordinary citizens to change their culture? Because I think that this is something which is going to take time. I remember now while we were speaking, do you remember when we had this crisis of the bird flu? Even the corpses of the dead, unfortunately, animals, or the dead animals in general, and by then it was dead birds. Unfortunately, many of them there were thrown into the branches of the Nile. So, which is which? I mean, which is first? Is it the governmental, industrial, or the ordinary citizen, or both together in parallel, or what?
Both together, and we need a clear legal and series of laws. We have already law number 48 for protecting the Nile River since 1982.
You mean the implementation?
The implementation of the laws and the executive regulations.
How, Dr. Haitham, how we can actually impose the law on the people and start to impose penalties and maybe sentences for those who are violating the River Nile?
This is the main role of the Ministry of Interior Affairs, of Ministry of Interior. But before that, we need the public awareness, and in that case, we need the important role of the media.
Yeah.
The media should play a very important role to increase the awareness of the citizens. And also, you could imagine that we have more than 1,000 factories. They are throwing their waste water through the Nile.
Solid waste.
And also the waste water, which has some materials which exceed the limits in the environmental law. We have the environmental law number 4 for the year 1994. So all those, we need just to activate the legal steps by the Ministry of Interior. And before that, we need a public awareness and also the social responsibility.
Do you think that this is going to play a role to defend our stance regarding the Renaissance Dam? I mean, we do have now a consultancy office. If they proved that we do not respect the Nile, unfortunately, or we do not protect the Nile as it should be protected, do you think that this is going to weaken our stance? I mean, they are going to say, whenever you are not respecting the Nile and you're doing what you're doing here, why you were that much eager to have your share? Protect your Nile first and then think about your share.
Our share is our right, and this is another,
another issue, of course.
So we preventing the pollution of the Nile for ourselves, because this water, we receive this water after it passed already. So just to reduce the pollution and also improve the efficiency of water
usage.
I'm
not saying, sir, that this is, our rights are going to be neglected, but I'm saying that our stance are going to be weakened if it was proved that we do not respect our artery of goodness.
Yeah, but this is, during the negotiations, this is a clearly interior affairs. It should not be included in any negotiation. And this, we just, if we fulfill all the requirements, we have some, we are not zero protect. Respecting the Nile River, we just want to improve the existing situation.
I mean, here, sir, propaganda
yes.
and media can play a role.
Yes, it can play a role, but the negotiation, we are just about Renaissance Dam. The building of Renaissance Dam will have a negative impact on the water quality coming to Egypt. Water quality.
Why?
Because you could imagine in that dam, there will be a reservoir or lagoon.
Yes.
This lagoon, when it water, it will increase. All this, there is some forest and plants in which it will dissolve in the water, and the water will come to Egypt with lower quality comparing to the existing water quality situation. Water quality in Lake Nasser is completely pure. This is very clear. But after building Renaissance Dam, it will have a negative impact on the water quality arriving to Egypt. How much? It should be scientifically quantified.
We drink water just like that from boats when we are in Aswan.
But you could imagine that more than about 1,500 kilometers square will be sunken, and all those material that will be dissolved in along the year. So in that case, we should just quantify in our negotiation that building the Renaissance Dam will reduce the water
the quality.
The quality of water. But inside Egypt,
this is a very important
issue. Yes, inside Egypt, this is really a critical situation. We have just one source coming from Aswan. All water subtracted from Nile River are returning back to the basin, because we are using water. It passed through the drains and the pump station, returning water inside the basin. Yesterday, Prime Minister Mehreb visited Manzala because it suffered from a serious environmental problem.
Yes.
You could imagine that more than 6 billion meter cube of water without treatment are thrown through this lake. Water quality has been dramatically reduced. It has been recorded some toxic materials. The production of the fish.
And once it was one of the big fisheries we have.
Yes.
But how the situation was left until this very dramatic level of pollution and toxification, and which is threatening not only the purity and of the water, but the whole environment. So how can we prevent such cases from being repeated again, Dr. Haiz?
From the current government, it's a responsibility, I think that, but we need a huge investment for treating all this amount of water. In addition to that, just don't forget that we suffer from a serious, the problem of water pollution, it was not the first problem in the past 30 years. So we are suffering now from a serious problem. It is not just one problem. This is started from the building of Aswan High Dam. Because after building the Aswan High Dam, don't remember that before that, water are coming with big quantity and they are making a flushing for all the basin until the Mediterranean. But after building Aswan High Dam, the waterborne disease has been increased. This is a clear negative impact of our dam. So after that, we decide just we want to use more fresh water, but we should just treat it all the water coming back or returning back to the system.
And agricultural waste,
wastewater
is also another issue we have.
We have three types of wastewater: agriculture, industrial, and residential or municipal wastewater. So the main problem is that inside the Egyptian village, there is no treatment wastewater treatment
this
plant.
This was my coming question, sir. When we are going to say whose responsibility is this? I mean, is it going to be the responsibility of the Ministry of Environment or Agriculture or Industry or Interior even, or all of them should coordinate together for the sake of saving the Nile?
All of them should coordinate, but who is responsible for surface water quality and monitoring is the Ministry of Environment. Who is responsible of the management of water resources is the Ministry of Water Resources. Who is responsible for using the pesticides inside the farms is the Ministry of Agriculture. So as you mentioned, this is a clear responsibility for four ministers under the supervision of the Prime Minister. You just remember when President Sisi came, he rejected the proposal of feeding Sinai with water because the water quality problem. And he mentioned clearly that we don't want to feed discharge water to make agriculture expansion inside. We have five lakes. The most clean lake is Bardawi Lake, is located in Sinai, because there is no agriculture wastewater coming. So this is a clear responsibility, as you mentioned, for all the ministers. Yes.
Dr. Haitham, what about the industry of fishery and how it was affected by polluting the River Nile and polluting the lakes as well? And how can we preserve it from any pollution in the future?
About water quality, this is one problem. This has triple direction.
Yep.
And also the seawater intrusion, in addition to that, the reduce of the salinity of the lakes. Because now all the fisheries, the fish types are planted inside the nursery are tilapia. We need just to use the sea bass and sea bream because the seawater fish, because it has a higher return value comparing to the freshwater fish. Also, it has been noticed that inside the nursery lake, the production has been reduced from the fisheries from the open areas, because the water quality has clearly reduced and there is some algae and bacteria has been recorded in those areas. This case has been recorded in Brolos Lake and Manzala Lake. Clearly, and especially in Manzala Lake, in the eastern part of the lake, two main drains, Bahr al-Baqar drain and Hadous drain, came inside this lake. And also it has been recorded in some place in Brolos Lake. So how we could reduce the pollution inside this lake? By building, for example, weirs to make a sediment trap of those pollution and upstream those weirs before reaching the Manzala Lake, or redirected those drains. There is about five ideas under the research activity now.
Studies now.
And now what we do it exactly is just make dredging of the strait connecting those lakes with the Mediterranean Sea. With a project in which Prime Minister has declared yesterday with more than 55 million Egyptian pounds just to clean the strait, the connection between the Manzala Lake and the Mediterranean Sea.
But sir, do you think that this is a field which can attract investors? I mean, you know, whenever we are talking financially, money talks.
Yes.
So is it going to be the sole responsibility of the government or the private sector should participate?
The private, if you want to provide Egyptian with protein, for example, the chicken or meat, we have a very good opportunity in the fisheries because we are now introducing a new the fish cages. In addition to that, using the seawater industry, seawater fish industry in Egypt, which we are building
for
now.
For processing,
we are building now two main hatcheries just. So a lot of foreign investor has recorded that they are very interested in investing in the fisheries. how they could invest in the fisheries. The government should reduce the water quality problem, pollution, inside the northern areas in there. And also, in one of the main directions for Swiss Canal Regional Development Project is to build some fisheries farms, fisher farms in the eastern part of the Swiss Canal. So this is a clear one of the main directions of the government to encourage foreign investors to come to Egypt.
Yeah. Dr. Haitham, do you believe that the fishing industry could be an important source of income and an important industry in the coming phase? And how can we improve this industry? What are the steps that should be taken in order to improve it?
Yes, it is a very important issue in investment. The fisheries, now Egypt is ranked number 9 in the world in the fisher production.
Nine.
We produce more than 1.5 million ton of fish every year. 1.5 million ton. But the main problem is that 90% of this quantity are freshwater fish. Mm. Only 150,000 ton are produced from the sea. Mm. So our plan in Egypt here is to introduce this quantity. But in the Mediterranean and the Red Sea, there is no fish. So if you notice that all the fisheries in Egypt are going to Libya or the south to Yemen, because this is considered from a scientific point of view as the desert of the Mediterranean. Mm-hmm. There is no fish. So now the government has a clear plan to introduce what is called hatchery, in which we get nursing of the fish and produce a small fish. We have now a plan under construction now, a fishery, a hatchery, in the kilometer 21 in Alexandria, and a new hatchery in Sinai Governorate. So if those hatchery will produce...
Are we having the same problem also in the Red Sea?
The Red Sea fish is not... We are just talking about producing sea bream and sea bass.
Yeah. Mm.
So those two quality of fish, you could imagine that 1 kilogram of fish in Europe is about 15 euro. Mm. So our plan is to... But comparing to the freshwater fish is 1 euro or less than this.
Yes, indeed. So, yes, of course.
The main problem of Red Sea is that the salinity is relatively higher. Mm. So the skin of the fish is relatively more thick.
Mm.
So the consumers doesn't like the Red Sea quality.
And of course, the Mediterranean Sea fish are very famous of their good qualities.
Is higher than the... higher than the sea fish quality. So the plan is just we need to introduce hatcheries and to increase the knowledge of this new industry, just to increase the production of the fish in Egypt. Despite that, we are exporting every year 200,000 ton of fish, which is called fish like tuna or
processed fish.
So this could not
and
be
canned.
We could not produce those type of fish in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
So reducing the pollution will have a direct impact on the increasing the fish production in Egypt.
In your opinion, sir, how much should it take? I mean, to reach our aim to protect our Nile, to have clean, potable water. To get rid of every and each violation, unfortunately, we are committing against the Nile. How much should it take? I mean, we have started. So, is it, I should say, something on the long run, or it should start from now and end as soon as possible?
We should have a milestones. Mm. Now, it is clear that nobody is building any slums on the Nile River. This is a very good step comparing to the past 3 years.
Mm.
Now we have more than 50,000 slums. It should be removed within 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
After that, we are talking about the water quality. Yesterday, the Ministry of Environmental Affairs in Egypt will establish a new monitoring system to monitor all the water quality. We have already a monitoring system just to improve the existing monitoring system to monitor the water quality. And if you noticed, for the Ministry of Environmental, they are producing every year a water quality report.
Mm-hmm.
We have the water quality report in the past 10 years. Mm-hmm. We just want to see the new report, if there is a new water quality or not, just to follow all the laws that we have. The water and water quality also. In addition to that, we should tackle those two problems in a parallel direction just to improve the water quality situation in Egypt. because we are investing a lot of money in for the water treatment plant coming to Cairo or Alexandria. We have more than 200 water treatment plants in Egypt. Mm-hmm. If the water coming to those plants are with lower quality, the operation, they stop those plants. And we suffer this in Alexandria, for example, because I am from here, that we have a water treatment plant problem in the kilometer 40 on the Nubarak Rail, which regularly stopped because the water coming is with very low quality, in which they could not producing a clean water from those plants. Mm-hmm. So regarding to your question, yes, we have short and medium and long term. Mm-hmm. For the short term, we should stop the slums and reducing the pollution to fulfill the Egyptian standard. After that, for the short term or long term, the seawater intrusion problem, in addition to that, to increasing the water quality up to international levels. Mm-hmm. We could notice in the street that a lot of Egyptians doesn't know how it is important the Nile River to us. You could notice that there is some people are making irrigation of the road just to increase or reducing the humidity, which is just wastewater.
And washing the car, the scene that we see every single day in front of all the buildings. Yes. With potable water.
You know why? Because water is very cheap. If you compare
I believe, sir, now the water pricing has increased.
This is a very critical. 1 meter cube of water in our houses, we pay 1 Egyptian pound.
Until now?
Yeah, around 1 Egyptian pound. If the mineral water, 1 liter is with 2.5 Egyptian pounds. So the 1 meter cube is 2,500 Egyptian pounds.
Yeah.
So equivalent to foil or petrol. So just what is the price of 1 meter cube of water? This is very critical. It could vary from zero Egyptian pound inside the farms up to 2,500 Egyptian pound in the mineral water that we buy from the supermarket. So what is the price of the water is very critical. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So do you believe that the solution here is to increase the pricing of water in order to prevent this misusage of water by certain citizens? Or how can we increase the awareness of the people concerning that issue?
Not increasing the prices, but making a penalties
for those who are doing that.
Yes, because we are coming now to a social responsibility for that. Just making a penalty who are not respecting the Nile River, according, and this is very good step that the president already inked that document, Nile protecting document.
This is not negotiable anymore.
Yes.
We should protect our Nile, and this is something which should be a must.
Yes.
This is something urgent, and as I said, no mercy here regarding water. It's our national security and it's our life. Dr. Haitham Mamdouh Hawad, Head of Irrigation Engineering Department and Hydraulics at Alexandria University. Thank you very much for being with
us,
sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Haitham. And now a new campaign was launched recently to help children with cancer to tolerate their pains and their treatment with the art and drawing to shed more light with Nirmin Abdurrahman in the following report.